The focus should be on carbon dioxide and making sure in your business practices it doesn't hit the air. And for all of the CO2 molecules that you can't stop from hitting the air, you remove from the air. And if you want to call that a net zero target, great. If you want to call it something else internally, that's fine too. But I think at the end of the day, it's the carbon that matters.
Yeah, it's the absolute number of carbon molecules in the atmosphere.
Yep, that's the ballgame.
And it really just comes down to 1 + -1 = 0.
Yeah, yeah. Math is, if the math maths, then it does.
I love that. Hi, my name is Anna Stukas. I'm here in New York City with Jack Andreasen from Breakthrough Energy. Welcome to Speaking in Tons. Jack, thanks so much for joining us today. We're going to dive into a couple fun questions, get things started with perhaps one of my favorite fashion pieces of all DAC-ness. You recently wore this DAC suit to DAC Day in 2024. How do you think a good communications and marketing strategy can really, even with fun things like the DAC suit, can pave the way for creating policy change?
Yeah, well, I first want to give a shout out to the Breakthrough Energy team, which gave me gifted me this this DAC suit as a wedding gift. I own another Adidas track suit that I sort of wore ironically to a team retreat that we had, and so they surprised me and my wife Ryan before a wedding with one. So it's an incredible piece of fashion. But I think, you know, from a practical standpoint, policy in and of itself is very dry. It's very focusing on nitty gritty details that most everyday folks will never come across. It will never be material to them unless they're seeing the consequences of that policy. The DAC suit is deployed tactically and strategically within my wardrobe, but I think it's a conversation starter. I had a number of people come up to me and they were like, wow, I love this. Where did you get it? What, like, give me the backstory. And then from then you can have a very serious conversation, right? And you can sort of reiterate like what your policy positions are, how critical you think it is. I'm an internal optimist. I will always be optimistic. I think human beings are incredible at driving change forward. Silly, you know, sort of is on its face, like a track suit can be a physical manifestation of optimism.
I love that. I think that piece about hope, it's so important. If you think that it's a fait accompli, that it's just all going to fail, then you're far less likely to take action. That need for optimism and hope, I think, is so important.
Yeah.
You often use social media to push back against things that you disagree with, particularly in the narratives around CDR, carbon dioxide removal, and direct air capture. Why do you feel it's important to engage in that way?
There are multiple avenues in which I like to push back. One is just factually incorrect information. I think carbon management broadly as a climate change solution suffers from a history of poor PR and the unwillingness to defend itself publicly around some of the just actually incorrect information out there. So that's like one avenue. I think the second is education. My sort of greater background is in geologic storage of CO2. It's usually the first thing that comes up in conversations with folks about things that they're nervous about, because it is, on its face, kind of wild to be able to take CO2 as a gas. And of course, you're pressurizing it to supercritical, but even when you say supercritical, folks' eyes sort of glaze over. What is that?
Or they think it's scary.
Right, exactly. Supercritical is kind of a scary word, but when you're taking a gas, and then you say, oh, don't worry, we're gonna drill a well potentially, you know, 8,000 feet underground, and then we're going to pump gas into a rock. That sounds wild.
It does.
Sounds crazy.
And people who I talk to often think that there's this giant balloon underground that you're pumping all this gas into. You're going to expand it like a balloon. And when you've got that image in your head, you start to worry that that balloon is going to pop at some point.
Yeah. Exactly. And so on the educational piece, like, I think this is so important because social media has a really wide reach. And if you can be viewed as like a trusted good faith actor, it's an incredible communication tool, most importantly for carbon management, which is in dire need of positive communication.
So we talk about how you make this more real for people. How do you take something that's so esoteric as pulling carbon out of the air with basically a giant vacuum cleaner and putting it safely and securely deep underground. It's It's not a balloon. It's actually going into rocks just like this. When you talk about how you make things real and how you bring this to life for people, what do you find most effective?
The first thing is like finding your audience, right? So if I'm talking to somebody on the Hill or somebody with the ability to affect policy, most of the time they're actually sort of less interested in the technology itself and more interested in the benefits that technology could bring, which is completely understandable because policy at the end of the day has downstream effects to it.
Right.
And so direct air capture has an incredible potential for economic development, for jobs in local communities, as 1.5 is as evidence of, whether it's in Stratos, whether it's in Kingsville with the South Texas DAC Hub program. So, you know, when I'm talking to policymakers, we like to talk about what this means for their constituents, because at the end of the day, that's who they're beholden to. You know, they're working on behalf of their voters. You know, and when I'm talking to sort of like the general public, you know, analogies are really helpful because it is so abstract. And so understanding the idea of like, we're just going to take CO2 direct out of the air that we're breathing right now, very understanding. They get that. How to do it, I think, you know, the idea of a filter is very effective in the same way that like a Brita filter potentially in your fridge works by filtering out whatever sort of constituents are in your water. It's the same idea. We're just filtering out CO2. And then once we filtered out the CO2, you know, when you put it underground, I think the best analogy is a sponge. Is you can think of rocks, although we see them as these sort of hard physical substances, which they are, the way CO2 interacts with it is much more like water into a sponge. And then, you know, the next question is like, well, what, you know, when you take a sponge and you wring it out, what then happens to the CO2 in this analogy? And I say, yeah, now imagine you buried a sponge 8,000 feet underground and you've got that much earth on top of it. The water is just not going to go back up. That's just not how physics work. And so I think through using analogies that people can really grapple with, it's effective.
Helps them to wrap their heads around it. I mean, we get the question of, don't we need CO2? Like,
yeah.
Plants need CO2. It's like, well, yes, you need some CO2, but not too much CO2. I actually just this morning likened it to like you're trying to sleep in the middle of the summer, but with a really thick down blanket on.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like we've put a big, heavy blanket on the earth.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, I come from a family farm in Nebraska, and, you know, my uncles will say like, well, you know, frequently heard isn't CO2 plant food, which of course it is. Like, that is very true. And it is also true that the production of vegetation can go up with increasing CO2 levels. But there's also a lot of negative consequences that come for humanity with increases in CO2 levels. And that's what we're really trying to balance.
What can government do, or what role can government play in the long-term growth of carbon dioxide removal?
Governments, first and foremost, can help set a price for what carbon looks like. And there's a number of different policies that they can do with that. But also, and maybe more importantly, government needs to set quality standards. We've seen challenges in the voluntary carbon market with what constitutes a real carbon credit. What is a real project? And real to me means the CO2 is removed. You can tell where that CO2 is, where you removed it. You can monitor where that CO2 is over time. And then, you know, that whole process is able to be verified by somebody. When you have this two-pronged approach of, in some areas, setting a price or saying, or a de facto price on carbon, and then also setting quality and saying what good CDR is, then you can allow companies and technology providers to come in and meet both of those at a price and at a standard that is set. And then you have competition thrive, pushing prices lower while keeping the standards the same and rigorous.
Right. That's setting the example for what good looks like.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then can see everybody looking to that. Not going to lie, my favorite climate policy is the low carbon fuel standard.
It's a great piece of policy.
It's also one of my favorite interview questions. What is your favorite climate policy?
I mean, my favorite climate policy for sure in my world, is 45Q. I mean, it's the most important piece of policy when you look at carbon management projects actually getting announced. When you have a dedicated revenue stream of at least 12 years, that's real financability, that's real bankability, that's sort of support gets projects built.
We saw the U.S. Department of Energy come out earlier this year and really challenge private companies to follow its lead on purchasing high-quality carbon dioxide removal. What kind of public-private partnerships do you think could be beneficial to the goals of emissions reduction and carbon removal?
When you look towards private industry, one thing they can do very well is move fast, and they can move relatively large amounts of capital pretty quickly. When you have, again, government setting the standard, that gives companies the ability to go out and say, okay, well, we have $1 billion to spend on this. We're going to use U.S. government standards for this, and you have to meet that in order to reach procurement for us. That's very powerful. And then what they did with the purchasing price in matching dollar amounts is fantastic. I mean, that's kind of the goal, right, is to be able to say, all right, taxpayer, for every $1 you put in, we get $3 of private capital. We get $5 of private capital.
Yeah, force multiplier effect.
Yes.
And as a taxpayer, I mean, it makes me happy to see that the government is spending money responsibly and seeing, you know, private corporations coming to the table and putting their money where their mouth is.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, in particular, direct air capture is not cheap to build. These are $1 billion facilities. You can't greenwash your way out of putting steel in the ground on a $1 billion facility. That's just not how that works.
You know, we often hear less so today, but I think in the early days of carbon removal, we heard a lot of talk about the moral hazard. Well, if you can just clean it up afterward, then there won't be the pressure or the imperative to reduce emissions. But in fact, we need all of the above. We need to reduce, we need to reuse, we need to recycle, and we need to remove. We need the full gamut.
Yeah, absolutely. We need every tool in the toolkit. I mean, we're already behind on basically every target that we've set out to hit. It doesn't make any sense to me to limit the amount of tools that you have. Even if we were to get down and be able to reduce all the way to zero, which would be great, legacy emissions are a real use case for CDR. We need it now, we need it yesterday, and we're gonna need it going forward for historic emissions too.
Absolutely, and we can't just snap our fingers in 2049 and magically have billions of tons of carbon removal appear in time for net zero in 2050.
Yeah, these technologies are complex, they take a lot of research and development, and you can't just, it's perfectly said, you can't just snap your fingers and these become real at scale in 2050.
Do you think that a net zero target in particular is something that companies should be striving for or putting together, or is there a better metric?
The focus should be on carbon dioxide and making sure in your business practices it doesn't hit the air. And for all of the CO2 molecules that you can't stop from hitting the air, you remove from the air. And if you want to call that a net zero target, great. If you want to call it something else internally, that's fine too. But I think at the end of the day, it's the carbon that matters.
Yeah, it's the absolute number of carbon molecules in the atmosphere.
Yep, that's the ballgame.
And it really just comes down to 1 + -1 = 0.
Yeah, yeah. Math is, if the math maths, then it does.
I love that. What do we need to use carbon removal for? Are there places where maybe we should use carbon removal sooner than later?
Yeah, absolutely. Carbon removal is sort of the last resort of things, and that's just pure physics, because removing carbon out of the ambient air is very difficult. It's thermodynamically incredibly inefficient, and yet we have to do it. And so then you look at industries where we just don't have cost-competitive alternatives at the moment. And so for things like aviation, carbon dioxide removal makes sense right now. These emissions that we have, planes, the agricultural sector, some deep industrial sectors like plastics, for example, where the alternative to doing this, the clean version of doing this, the non-emitting way of doing this, is so expensive right now that CDR is actually the cheapest way, at least for the moment, to decarbonize. And where that is true, we should do it.
What's one piece of advice that you would give to companies that are developing carbon removal and DAC technologies to communicate their vision to potential buyers?
If you're going to sell carbon removal to any buyer, the first thing is to communicate the certainty of the CO2 molecule. Run it from the moment it's taken from the air to the moment it's, you know, locked away. And so being able to communicate across technical boundaries is really key. And then understanding it's a partnership. You're not just selling them a removal and then saying, hey, see you later, walking out the door, and that's it. This is a partnership that you need to nurture throughout the entirety of this? Because when their CO2 molecule gets removed, if you're doing geologic storage in rocks like out in Stratos, that's going to stay in the supercritical phase for hundreds, potentially thousands of years until it turns back into stone. That means their asset, the CO2 they bought, is with you for hundreds to thousands of years. And that relationship is really important to make sure that as you communicate exactly how you're going to do what you do in a way that they can understand, they also realize that this is a commitment that they're making, not just to you as the technology provider, as the removal person of the CO2, not just as a commitment to climate that they're making here, but a commitment that will be honored for 1,000 years. And that is a sort of relationship building that I think companies can get behind, because at the end of the day, companies want certainty.
Awesome. I love that. Thank you so much, Jack, for spending time with us today. Really, really appreciate it. And just a delight, as always, to chat with you.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's been awesome.